morning and welcome to church this morning.
Can't hear you.
No.
So we have a slightly different service this morning.
Can't hear you.
And so there's lots of different elements happening in church this morning than what we would normally have. So, but the main purpose of us being here, the reason we're together is to worship our God together. And how grateful we are for his love and his sacrifice for us. It's 9 days since we remembered Good Friday. It's 7 days since we remember Resurrection Sunday. And this morning we focus on some things that are coming up tomorrow with Anzac Day. But let us not lose sight of the sacrifice that our Saviour paid for us. But we can rejoice. We can praise our God. Let's stand together and do that together this morning. The battle belongs to the Lord.
Battle belongs to the Lord.
Morning.
Morning.
Morning. I'm just going to do the reading for today. So if you want to join with me to Isaiah 2, verse 4. He will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Just join with me in prayer. Lord, thank you for your word, and we thank you for bringing us here today, Lord. And we just pray for all those who are currently in conflict around our world. Lord, we pray that they will, you will just provide an end to all disagreements, and especially what's happening with Russia and Ukraine, Lord. Just pray for your provision and your hand there. We also pray for all of our servicemen and women who are working, who are overseas currently or returned, Lord. Just pray peace and protection over them as well. And we just pray, we thank you for your word today and that it's true now and forevermore. Amen.
We have an opportunity now to worship God with our offering. And I've asked Tyson and Amelia if they would take up the offering for us this morning. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, Lord, we come here to be able to say thank you for the great things that you have done. Lord, we come on the back end of Easter and in remembrance of how you laid your life down so that we could be rescued from the depths of the consequences of our sin. And we come and say thank you, Lord, that you came to take our sin and give us your righteousness. Lord, we come with a heart's yearning to come together with the thing that draws us together the most, and that is the love and our devotion to worship you and bring glory to you and to share you with more and more people. Lord, I pray that today as we come to reflect on your greatness, but also to come and to remember those who have fallen, to be able to make our country great, and those who are serving, Lord, let us come to pray for them, for their souls, as they may find darkness in the midst of the trenches of where they are. Lord, let them find that they can find hope in you. Lord, we pray that in the midst of this time, as we remember over this weekend, our Anzacs, Lord, let us come to be able to cry out to you for peace. Lord, you're a God that does not desire for your children who are healed through the Spirit or broken through sin to be able to come and find love, restoration and peace. And so, Lord, we pray for peace. We pray for peace within our families. We pray for peace within our community. We pray for peace within our nation. Lord, as the time comes where we see politicians looking at trying to undermine and pull down each other, Lord, let us see a nation that looks to encourage and aspire and have integrity. Lord, we pray for peace in the midst of this election time. But Lord, we pray for peace within our world as well, for those nations out there that are war-stricken. Lord, we pray that even in the midst of that, Lord, we know that we can, as we find rest with you, we find comfort and power through you, that we can find peace that transcends all understanding, even in the midst of the turmoil and the conflict. So Lord, we pray for peace. We ask this in Jesus' name, and all God's people say,
amen.
That's good. Don't sit down. I know you probably don't do this very often. I haven't seen it since I've been here. But I want you to turn around and say hello to someone. Maybe if you haven't said hello to someone yet that you see, then go and say hello to them. I'm going to give you 20 seconds. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one. Everybody stop. No more talking, no more laughter, no more smiling. I have a thing with the kids where I call it the holy hush, and it's, what is it? I can't even remember. Anyway, don't worry about that one. It's great to have you here and joining with us this morning, and I want to be able to extend a warm welcome to visitors, people who are maybe here having a look. We invite you. After the service, we do have some barista coffee and great things like that. We don't have morning tea though, do we? We do. We have morning tea today. How cool is that? Give a clap. That's great. We've got morning tea on after the service today, so I'd love for you to join with us and enjoy a time of cuppa and a tea, but more importantly, we get to enjoy each other's fellowship, yeah? So that's great. From there, I want to share a few announcements with you this morning. Hopefully you've received one of these bulletins. They're really great, hey? We get to open it up and see information that's happening in the life of our church. So grab that and have a read. You might see there's something a little bit amiss, and that's okay. But on the front, it says that I'm preaching. I'm not preaching. Well, I liked this side's response. Not so pleased with Colin. But we've got our lovely John Belmonte John Belmont, coming to share the word with us this morning. And then I'll be preaching next week. So get ready. In the midst of that, next week we're going to be starting a time where we're going to be looking into the book of Ephesians. So I would encourage you this week, open up the book of Ephesians and have a read. Read through the book of Ephesians so that you can come with an understanding of the fullness of the book of Ephesians. And maybe through that time you might ask questions about, I don't understand that. Ooh, that's a bit of a tricky one. I wonder how Pastor Phil's going to dive into that one. And we'll see how we go as we go through this series as well. But I want to just start also with saying we have Kids Club started on Thursday and it was great. And it was fantastic. Thank you to the leaders for what they do there. And encourage any kids in primary school age kids, you're more than welcome to come along. We also had playgroup that started up on Thursday morning as well. So that's a fantastic ministry too. So if you've got any families that have got kids that aren't in school yet, they're more than welcome to come along to our playgroup on a Thursday morning as well. Yesterday, we had our working bee. If you have a look around, the yards are looking amazing. And you know why you can see how great the yard's looking? Because we cleaned all the louvers as well. And so they look good. Thank you to everybody who came and helped and was a part of our working bee yesterday. Give them a round of applause. They did such a marvellous job as well. And as we're clapping, can we give our worship team a clap and an appreciation? They're fantastic too. A couple of things coming up. One, this after the service today at 11:30, we have our Working with Children and Vulnerable People safety training time. So that's starting at 11:30. For anybody who's got a blue card from our church, we want you to be a part of that. Anyone who's in our kids ministry, you should have a blue card from our church and we want you to be a part of that. Our leaders from our the hub and also the men's shed, any of our kids ministry leaders, yep, those groups of people, our stewards and our elders, and we would love to have you all here to be able to do this training. Starting at 11:30, for half an hour, we're going to then have lunch, and then we've got another half an hour session after that. We will be finished no later than 1:30, which means you'll all be able to pack up, go home, get yourself settled to watch Parramatta win the game at 2 o'clock, okay? So be sure that you'll be home to watch Parramatta play this afternoon from there. So if you're wondering about that. Now, I've got a few things happening next Sunday that I want to bring your attention to. The first thing is that we've got communion next Sunday, and we're going to be doing communion just a little bit different. But if you're looking back before COVID, you'll see it's the same. And that is because we're going back to the way that we did communion before COVID with the glass cups, with the bread in the serving trays and being able to have that time of fellowship together. Now, just to give you a bit of an understanding of maybe a little bit different, the people who are serving, they'll be sharing out the bread to you. They're going to be wearing a rubber glove and they're going to be putting it into your hands so that we're not having many fingers touching the bread. Now, the bread's going to be gluten-free, so everyone's going to be able to be a part of that. But we will have a couple of sealed closed communion cups out of the entry for those who may still feel that that's a bit too of a step too far. So, but only leave them to those who need it as well. So come along and be a part of that. And I want to acknowledge Carol and Robin for the great work that they do in preparing. Give them a clap as well for the work they do with our communion services. Next Sunday, we're going to be also having a missions dinner at 5 o'clock where we're going to be able to hear Bruce Bartlett and his family come and share about the great work that they do. Heather, where are they coming from?
Thailand.
They're coming from Thailand and they're here and they're going to be sharing in what work God is doing through their ministry over in Thailand. Now, I've also asked them not just to share about what God is doing, but what God has taught to them about how they can bring the gospel into a context of their community with the desire for us to grow and to learn how we can bring the gospel into the context of our community with the passion that we want to share that missional work with the people as well. Now, on the 7th of May, what's happening?
Mother's Day breakfast.
What time does it start? Can you just turn up on the day and just get some free feed?
No.
How? What do you got to do? buy a ticket. Go online. We've got an awesome website that you can go online, click on book a ticket and do it that way. Thank you for the couple of ladies who haven't been able to do that online and have had the guts to come and speak to me, and I've been able to do it for you. That's a great time that I get to actually know your name and your email address. But it's been wonderful. So if you need any help, come and see Linda or myself. We'll get somebody else and we'll love to have you there. And we've got our lovely Lynn who's in the back row coming in and sharing in the time of sharing as well. So that's going to be fantastic. Now also, I want to share, we've got morning tea starting up every week again from the 15th of May. So we're going to be starting morning tea up each week, and be at a part of that, I want to be able to share that the heart behind our morning tea is we want people to enjoy fellowship. Coming out of our fellowship of Sunday service, going into there and having fellowship through a cuppa, maybe a biscuit, and just enjoying each other's company and sharing about our great God together. And for that reason, the stewards have decided that we are going to buy the biscuits, the milk, the coffee, the sugar, and the tea. And all the people who are going to come and be a part of helping morning tea, all you're doing is bringing yourself and bringing and preparing it. So you're not going to be bringing big, good baked goods, and I think they're amazing. Heather makes these awesome brownies that I tried yesterday. They're awesome, but invite people over and have them there, because we're just going to have a simple morning tea served, but incorporate times of fellowship from there. Now, I know you guys are all really excited about having morning tea, and you want to be a part of that. And so for that reason, we've decided, instead of getting you to all come and say you're going to be a part of it, we've said that as a church family, we're all going to take turns in preparing morning tea. So you're going to get put onto a roster unless you come and see Janine. Janine, jump up and give a wave. So unless you go and see Janine over the next 2 weeks and say, look, I can't do the serving of morning tea, and Rue's going to be a part of it too, then you're going to be on the roster. And if that's the case, we should be able to do a roster where you're only on maybe once every 10 weeks. So it's not going to be overly burdensome for one person or a few, but we're all going to be able to be a participant in that. So that's going to be wonderful, and we'll share more information. But if you want to know more, go and see Janine or Rue as well, and they'll be able to share that information. Now, Kids Church is starting today. How awesome is that? It's going to be fantastic that we get to have Kids Church on now. And they're going to be able to go out into the back area and learn about Jesus in their own special way. But I thought it'd be exciting for us to get the leaders of our Kids Church who are here to stand up. If you're a leader of Kids Church, can you stand up? Hey, there's Linda and Esther. So they're leading our services today for Kids Church. And can we just pray for them? Wouldn't it be great to be able to pray for them and their ministry right now? Gracious Father, we want to thank you that you are a God that desires for every generation to know you, to love you, and to be able to share your love with others. And so for that reason, Lord, we come with a desire to teach our children who you are and how they can love and serve you as well. Lord, we pray for this ministry that they will be able to effectively share with our kids. Lord, let them love our kids, and we pray for our kids to not get out of control. We pray that our kids will come to know and to learn and to love you. And Lord, I pray that through this ministry, we'll see exciting fruitfulness come out of our church through our kids as well. Lord, we thank you for our leaders. We pray for safety. We pray for wisdom, and we pray for good health for them as well in the midst of this ministry too. And we pray for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, with Kids Church starting up, we will no longer be having our kids' packs out in the middle there to be able to do during the service. But that's been something that we have really appreciated through this time of COVID and through the beginning of this year. And so I think it's really important for us to be able to show our appreciation. So Leslie, can I get you to come up here? I know you don't like to be front and center, but I would love for you to be able to, because I've got something for you. I've got a little lure. I've got something for you. Millie, can you grab this? Can you take that down to Mrs. Leslie? Here she comes. Can you take that to Mrs. Leslie? Leslie, we thank you for the work that you have done. And as we got those flowers and we brought them, we had our girls and they were quite excited about the idea of flowers. And so when I told them what it was for, Millie has decided that she would like to pray for you and a prayer of thanks. So I'm going to ask Millie to come and pray now, but let me get a chair so you can stand up, okay?
Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for all the work that Mrs. Ludley has done. Please, can she help us go on and we have a really good time at church. Please, can you bless her of all the things that she's done through the year. Thank you, God, that we have her here and that she's done a lot of things to help us. Thank you so much, God, in your name, amen.
Amen. Now, at that note, kids leaders and parents, you're going to be able to take your kids out. So you'll be able to take them out through this next, at the beginning of this next song. And at the end of the service, in the last song, we'll invite you to go out and pick them up after the service as well. Fantastic. All right, kids and leaders, you can jump up and you can go out to kids' church.
And if the rest of you would like to stand, you can sing with us. Thank you.
this fortnight's been a great wrestle for me. Lord, just bless me, watch over me, protect me, and give me words that speak from you. Anzac Day is the theme of our church service, and it is a church service, but the theme is Anzac. Anzac in Australia and New Zealand are nationally important days. A day when we bring to memory the landing of the Australian and New Zealanders on the beaches of Gallipoli in Turkey 107 years ago. And we call to mind the cost. It is a day of mixed emotions as we recall the sacrifices and feelings of sadness at their loss. Predominantly the pride of our youth and a generation gone. But there's also a feeling of thankfulness for the freedoms and privileges that we have. I've been to many countries and you're free to come to church here without any issue. We have supermarkets full of food where you can select from 20, 50, 60 different types of bread. We're blessed. And it is on Anzac Day that we do not celebrate. We commemorate. We bring to mind. We bring to memory. There are certain symbols and themes that you see with Anzac Day. Some of you may know them. Some of you may not. Rosemary. We have a basket down the front with rosemary and poppies and crosses for later. But rosemary, as you see, rosemary from time way back into ancient times was used as an aid to memory. The other significance is that rosemary grows wild all across the Turkish peninsula. It's everywhere. The poppy, the red poppy, it symbolises peace, death, and the sleep of the fallen. It grows wild across the western front of World War I. You may have heard places such as Passchendaele, the Somme, Menin Gates, all those sort of areas. The poppy grows wild. I have my ribbons on today. My medals are on the altar where they belong. We wear these on our left-hand side, those who've received the medals. You could say that they're just medallic ribbons. They're a symbol of something extra, something deeper. And we wear them on our left side over our heart. The ode, which you will hear later, comes from the poet Lawrence Binyon. And it comes from the piece called For the Fallen. You hear of the term, Lest We Forget. It comes from Rudyard Kipling's poetry piece, The Recessional. And it means, it should not be forgotten. The eternal flame. The flame symbolises the eternal soul of all those that have served and died in war. And the flame continues to be an eternal remembrance of that gratitude. The slouch hat on the floor. How more iconic can you be of Australian forces? It's turned up on the left-hand side so they can shoulder a rifle without knocking their hat off. The other interesting set that you see on this slouch hat is a set of emu plumes. The emu plumes originated in Gympie in Queensland in the 1800s when we had militias, state militia. To be a good horseman, you'd ride out and you'd find an emu and you'd race against him and pluck out a tuft out of his tail. That's if you were a good horseman. And they'd put that into their hat as a symbol of their horsemanship. These days, the light horsemen, the Queensland Mounted Infantry, now have a heritage up to what we call tanks. I've served as an infantryman, that's a footman. I've worked with tanks, and I've also been a padre. Very different types of service. The boots. You'll see boots and you'll wonder what the boots are for. Well, the boots symbolise the last march. The last march from the mortal into the eternal. The riderless horse with its boots reversed symbolises the same. Last look back into the mortal as I ride into the eternal. You'll also see a rifle reversed. In ancient times, when a warrior fell, the Greeks would put their sword or their spear as a marker there on the battlefield. And in modern times, the rifle was used as a marker for the wounded or the dead. The cenotaph, concrete plinth for a memorial, comes from the Greek kentos and paph, an empty tomb, a place where we stop to remember those who have a grave, those who may not have a grave, those who may be buried overseas, or those who sleep beneath the waves. We will hear bugle calls a bit later. The reveille or the rouse is played in the morning. It's get out of the bed, get up, it's time. The military day has started, get to work. And the last post symbolises the end of the day. Evening, time for rest, lights out. However, on Anzac Day and Remembrance Day, we play these in reverse order. The last post signifies the last duties on earth. The minute silence is the transition, and the rouse or reveille is the awakening into the immortal. So as I begin my message and service, I hope that these points maybe bring a bit more of an emphasis on why we use them. But if you have a photo of a loved one, or a memento, or you're wearing the medals of a loved one, today I want you to remember that individual or individuals. If you wish to come and place a sprigget of rosemary, a poppy or a cross here in remembrance of that person, I'd invite you to do that now. And on this front chair here is rosemary, some poppies, and please come now and pay your respects. this past week as we've stopped to reflect on Good Friday and the message of Easter, the message of Jesus Christ, truly God and truly man, who came as an atonement for us. Whilst Easter and Anzac Day have some similar themes, they are fundamentally different. I see interwoven within the Anzac story those themes that touch on the gospel, but they are not the gospel. It demonstrates that light can still shine in the midst of darkness, and that good can overcome evil. I see underlying themes that have links to sacrificial living and of Jesus calling us to be his friends. And I read from John chapter 15, verse 12. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, that one lay down their life for their friends. This is a church service, not an Anzac Day service. And we stop to solemnly reflect on what will occur tomorrow, Anzac Day. All across Australia and New Zealand, people will gather at churches, memorials, parks, and other solemn places. From sea to shore, jungle to desert, they will gather. For some of our veterans, though, it will be a day that we will seek solitude. We will seek solace by ourselves, for some of us. And there are those who will wrestle with wounds, seen and unseen, the visible and the invisible. Tomorrow's dawn service is a very significant service. It is about reflection. It is in those quiet moments, these peaceful moments, just before the last darkness drifts away and the glimmering rays of the sun come out to meet us. It is just in those moments as the day begins to push away the darkness. We as a nation will stop and call to mind the landing of Anzac. Where we lost almost 2,000 Australians in under 24 hours. You may have seen the movie Gallipoli, or have an understanding that the Anzacs landed on some great golden sandy beach. Nothing of that is farther from the truth. I've personally stood on Anzac Cove. The beach is 20 metres deep, or in the old term, 60 feet. As soon as you make it that 60 feet, you're met by a cliff and steep ravines you need to scramble up. It's not a golden sandy beach. It's maybe a crimson stained beach. As we recount the story of our Anzacs in Gallipoli, we need to always remember what it really was about. Pain, suffering, men trying to do their best in the most arduous and awful of circumstances. From the beaches of Gallipoli up to the Neck, across to Lone Pine and Chunuk Bear, where the New Zealanders were, the entire peninsula is covered and dotted with cemeteries everywhere. For when humanity has been forced down into the darkness of war, we see people who have voluntarily stepped up and given more and brought more goodness. They've brought more kindness. They've brought more patience. They've brought more faithfulness. They've even brought joy, or that larrikin nature, where we somehow find humour in anything. And they have served in the promotion and to keep peace. But greatest of all, they've brought love. And for some of them, they've paid the ultimate sacrifice. I read from Charles Bean, the noted war historian, and this is what he wrote. It's a great gamble, the whole thing, really. And a lot of Australians, boys who begin their life on the Murray or in the backyard in Wagga, Berg, Surrey Hills, will be left lying in Turkey. Friends, I really want you to grasp this. I want you to put your own relatives and your own hometown into this. So I read again. Boys who began their life on the Murray or in the backyard of will be left lying in Turkey. Then I imagine hearing Charles Bean's voice heaving with the weight of the reality. Some of those positions, I believe, have to be taken, and taken at all costs. Oh, it cost. It cost dearly. 2,000 men within the first 24 hours. 2,000 of those fresh young boys from New Zealand had lost their lives within the first 24 hours. There's no way that we can comprehend the scenes of horror and destruction. But we hear it from a soldier of the 3rd Brigade who says, "Oh God, the sight of the dead and the wounded, absolutely covering the little beach. There is an enormous amount of men of medical backgrounds there to assist, but it's impossible to attend to them all. Many a life expires for lack of want." And for every one of those young men who struggled, suffered, became prisoners of war, or who were wounded or died, there was waiting at home a mother, a father, perhaps a wife and children, a fiancé or a sweetheart, brothers, sisters, cousins, friends and mates. They also experienced in their own way personal loss, grief, and wrestling whilst in a sea of anguish. This is the other aspect that we as a nation, as a state, as a town, and as a community need to face. Average day, everyday Australians and New Zealanders waiting at home for the news of a loved one, worrying and praying, caring for each other, crying with each other, endlessly searching the casualty lists, and steeling themselves every time they saw the feared telegram boy. My friends, it's important to pause. It's important to consider what conflict and war really is. Not only at Gallipoli 107 years ago, but through the century until this modern minute. There's also another cost that weighs heavily upon those in the highest levels of government who would commit our troops to war. When you walk out of Parliament House in Canberra, the first scene that you see is the Australian War Memorial. Straight down Anzac Parade, straight into the War Memorial, where you are reminded that there are 102,000 names listed there as those who have given the ultimate sacrifice. But within this story of loss, we see a story of sacrificial living, of giving, of loving. Anzac is not merely about the loss. It's also about courage, endurance, duty, love, mateship, good humour, and a survival of a sense of self-worth and decency in the most awkward circumstances. I catch a glimpse of something powerful. Something very powerful. Something so powerful that it is able to transfigure all that awfulness and anguish. The tradition and story of Anzac resonates with the very powerful story of Jesus Christ, the theme. It is this precious theme or thread of sacrifice, of love and of hope possible, that is interwoven into the Anzac story. Jesus said to his friends, "Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends." Love. I draw that out. It's from the Greek. It means agape. This love is a self-sacrificing love. It is a transcending, unconditional, pure love, regardless of all circumstances. It challenges us to put away the self-interest and the me-first attitude of modern life. It asks us to look deep into ourselves and ask, are we willing to give? Are we willing to give even though we know that we will get nothing in return? I also see the real possibility of being able to have a better way of being in community and being better men and women. It demonstrates in certain ways a universal truth of what is good, what is true, and what is proper. We catch a glimpse of this selflessness all around us. I see it in the faces of our sailors, soldiers, and Air Force members currently on operations overseas and at home. And I look and I see our veterans of many generations also, those who have served in peacetime and war, some who were volunteers, some who were national servicemen, and some who were conscripted. We see it in the self-giving and selfless love of our church and our community, those who bind up the wounds in our community, those who welcome people from many nations, who support our refugees and assist those who are down on their luck. We saw it in the faces and actions of the countless emergency service volunteers who serve and give to our communities. We saw it with the floods recently. Volunteers from everywhere giving selflessly. We saw it in the multitude of everyday people that came out as the Mud Army to go and give assistance to the fellow Australians that they didn't know during the recent floods. Friends, we are invited to make this rich and bold heritage part of our own story. It asks us to add this history of loving and giving to our own lives. It's seeking a life of not me, but gratitude. Working for the common good and caring for our community, healing up the wounds within. It is for us to bring hope, to promote reconciliation and be the restorers of peace. Some of us have served in the Defence Force during peacetime. Some of us have been on peacekeeping missions. And some of us have been to war. But all of us as Christians, all of us as the followers of Christ, are all called to pray for peace. We are all called to promote peace. And we are all called to protect the refugee, the widow, and the orphan. It is Jesus who calls out to us through his selfless love and his atonement for us and asks us to serve him. For our hope is in no other. Our salvation is only through Jesus Christ. And it is Jesus Christ who came to usher in a new kingdom. Jesus, who is the Prince of Peace. It is Jesus who will always be with us and promises to stand by us through whatever we are going through. And it is he who sets us free from our last great enemy. Ultimately, to be set free from sin and even death itself. If you're able, please be upstanding as I invite John Murdoch, a former National Serviceman, to read the ode for us.
Thanks, John. They shall not grow old as we the left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them.
Lest we forget.
Please remain upstanding as we play the last post, followed by a minute's silence and the rouse.
Thank you.
And for the benediction, my favourite, go forth into this world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the blessing of God our Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst us, remain with us, and go wherever we go this day and the days to come. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
Letting us know more depth of the significance. For some of us who are younger, we have been so blessed to have not had to face this this sacrifice. But we do carry scars from the battles that we have gone through. Civilian life is not just completely peaceful and happy and kind. But through it all, our God is with us. His plans are for our good. So even when things feel uncomfortable, painful, God has not deserted us. And he can bring good things out of things that our enemy, the devil, means to harm us, destroy us, tear us down. But God can bring good from that, and he can use that to bless others. I'll try not to get too emotional, but let's stand and sing this song. It's, another song that's, I find the words very significant. So let's sing it together.
Raining high above the heavens.
Thank you that this life is not all there is. That the hurts and the pains that we have been through, are going through, will go through in this life are not all there is. You do not desert us. You have promised to provide for us and take care of us and hold our hand with your strong hand. Thank you for that. May we never take lightly our faith in you. May we never take lightly the cost of the peace that you give us. Lord, as we were finishing that memorial part of the service, that reminder of the price that it took for us to be free in this country, I was reminded of your early followers, your disciples, your apostles, of Stephen who was stoned, of Paul who gave us so much information and teaching in all those letters he wrote. He was beheaded. Of Peter, who changed from being just a brash, wanting to be in charge person, to someone who loved you and served you and was crucified upside down. Lord, may we hold firm to you no matter the cost. May it be well with our soul. May we cling to that and know the joy of that. And the strength of that, the encouragement of that, that the hope we have in us, the hope of eternal life, which is not just a wishy-washy hoping it will be there, that's our hope, that's our strength, that's our foundation, that's our security. Lord, we thank you for that. Help us to share that truth, to save, to rescue, to defend our neighbours, our friends, our work colleagues, our family members who don't know you and who are facing the death of hell. Lord, may we share your salvation, the victory that you have won over death. Oh, Lord, thank you. Thank you so much. We love you and we are so grateful. May we never forget. Amen. Thank you for being part of our special service today, and enjoy some time of fellowship over morning tea, maybe sharing some stories with each other, but also encouraging each other to hold fast and walk daily with God. Amen.